Of GUT, we will discuss the development of the urinary bladder and urethra. First, we will discuss the development of the urinary bladder. So, this diagram you are aware that is the folding of the embryo forming the foregut, midgut, and hindgut. So, this is the buccopharyngeal membrane which separates the foregut from stomatodium, and this is the cloacal membrane which separates the proctodium from the cloaca. Now this portion allantois is just a diverticulum which is just arising from the hindgut, you can see. Now our concern is this portion for today's lecture. Now this cloaca is with the appearance of the urorectal septum, it is divided into primitive urogenital sinus and rectum. So simultaneously this cloacal membrane is also dividing into urogenital membrane in relation to the primitive urogenital sinus and anal membrane in relation to the rectum. Now this is a line diagram which is taken from your standard textbook. This cloaca is dividing into rectum and primitive urogenital sinus with the appearance of urorectal septum. Now this primitive urogenital sinus is important for today's lecture because it is dividing into two portions, that is vesicourethral canal and definitive urogenital sinus. Now the fate of this vesicourethral canal is urinary bladder and primitive urethra, and definitive urogenital sinus is further divided into pelvic and phallic part. So these parts are contributing to the urethra too. So but the initial portion of the urethra is just arising from this portion, vesicourethral canal. Now primitive urogenital sinus now is divided into two parts, that is cranial vesicourethral canal, you can see here, and caudal portion which is definitive urogenital sinus. And the opening of the mesonephric duct lie at the junction of these two subdivisions. So this is vesicourethral canal, this is definitive urogenital sinus, and this is the opening of mesonephric duct. Now this definitive urogenital sinus, this portion is further divided into two portions, that is cranial part which is known as the pelvic part and caudal portion which is known as the phallic part. Now with this knowledge, the upper large dilated part of the vesicourethral canal, it contributes to the urinary bladder. It is continuous with the allantois at the apex, and this allantois later on it obliterates and forms a fibrous band called urethrus, you can see in the diagram. Then this is extending from the apex of the urinary bladder to the umbilicus. This urethrus is called as median umbilical ligament. Now coming to this diagram, the lower narrow part of the vesicourethral canal, it contributes to the primitive urethra. So these are the two parts of the vesicourethral canal. The upper dilated portion is contributing to the urinary bladder and lower portion is contributing to the primitive urethra. Now this mesonephric duct open into that part of the cloaca which forms the urogenital sinus. You can see which is going to form the urogenital sinus. That portion is receiving the mesonephric duct. So this is the mesonephric duct. This is the urogenital sinus. Now this ureteric buds, they are arising from the mesonephric duct. As we know from our previous knowledge of the lecture of the kidney and ureter development, so this ureteric bud is arising from the mesonephric duct. Now with this knowledge, all these diagrams are taken from your standard textbook, you can refer those books too. The part of the mesonephric ducts caudal to the region of ureteric bud, so this portion, they are absorbed in the vesicourethral canal. The mesonephric duct and the ureteric buds have separate opening in the vesicourethral canal. Now with the absorption of this portion, that is caudal portion, these two portions, they have separate opening into the vesicourethral canals. Now as the kidney ascends, the opening of the ureter, they move upward and laterally. So that from where the trigone of the urinary bladder is arising, after the absorption of the mesonephric duct into the vesicourethral canal, the mesonephric duct and the ureteric buds have separate opening in the vesicourethral canal, that is primitive urinary bladder. At first, the opening of the mesonephric duct and the ureteric bud are close together, you can see in the diagram, but later on the ureteric buds, they with the movement or ascent of the kidney, these openings, they move cranially and laterally. So these are the ureteric openings. with the ascent of the kidney, these openings, they move upward. The triangular area on the dorsal wall of the vesico-urethral canal between the opening of the ureteric bud and the mesonephric duct, this portion is called as trigone of the bladder. So it is absorbed from the absorption of the mesonephric duct. Now the urinary bladder has different cords. So from where these cords are developing, the epithelium of the urinary bladder is developing from the cranial part of the vesico-urethral canal, which is endodermal. The epithelium of the trigone of the bladder is derived from the mesonephric duct, which is mesodermal in origin. The muscular and serous cords are derived from the subplanknopleuric mesoderm. The median umbilical ligament is derived from allantois. With this knowledge, we can understand the congenital anomalies of the urinary bladder. So the common one are the ectopic vesicae, hourglass bladder, lumen of the bladder may be divided into compartments by septa, the congenital diverticulum, then the urinary bladder may be absent or duplicated, then fistulae may be there, the congenital anomalies of urethrus. First is the ectopic vesicae or extrophy of the bladder. This is important, sometimes you get the clinical note on this. The lower median part of the anterior abdominal wall and anterior wall of the urinary bladder is absent in this case. The mucosal surface of the posterior wall of the urinary bladder showing ureteric opening, which is exposed to the surface, you can see here. Once the anterior abdominal wall is not developed in this region, so definitely the ureteric orifices, these orifices are exposed to the surface. So once they are exposed, the urine can be seen dribbling intermittently from these orifices. What are the causes of ectopic vesicae? It may be due to lack of migration of the mesoderm in lateral fold of embryo in the hypogastric region. Then it may be because anterior abdominal wall is not formed in the hypogastric region between umbilicus and genial tubercles. Then as a result, the surface ectoderm come in contact with the endoderm of vesico-urethral canal. So continuity is there between the ecto and endoderm. The posterior wall of the urinary bladder is exposed. Condition is rare and normally accompanied with epispadias. Second anomaly is hourglass bladder. The upper and lower compartments of the bladder are formed because of the constriction in the middle. You can see this is hourglass bladder. Then fistulae. So the various fistulae which can appear is rectovesical fistula due to incomplete urorectal septum, then vesicovaginal fistula. So Müllerian eminence is elevation in dorsal wall of the phallic part of the urogenital sinus formed by the fused caudal end of paramesonephric duct. If Müllerian eminence is projected into the vesico-urethral part of the canal cloaca, it results into vesicovaginal fistula. So this portion you will better understand when we will discuss the development of the vagina. So then is urethral fistula. Now urethral fistula we will discuss under the heading of congenital anomalies of urethrus. Urethrus is, we know, adult derivative of the allantois. In adult it is obliterated and persists as median umbilical ligament that we have discussed in our previous slide. If it persists, falling anomalies can occur. First is urethrus sinus. Now in this case the lumen persists in the upper part of the urethrus. So sinus has blind end, so it is exposed or it opens at the umbilicus. So this is known as urethral sinus. Rest of the portion of the urethrus is replaced by the fibrous tissue. Then is urethral fistula. Fistula has two openings at two ends. That is, lumen persists along the entire extent. It opens in the urinary bladder at one end and at the umbilicus at the other end. As a result, the urine is discharged through the umbilicus. Then is cyst. If only small part of the urethrus it remains patent, the secretory activity of its lining epithelium leads to formation of cystic swelling called as urethral cyst. Now coming to the development of urethra. Male urethra is divided into, you can see the diagrams. So again I am just telling you that these diagrams are taken from your standard textbooks. So male urethra is divided into four parts, that is prostatic urethra, membranous part, spongy part and glandular part. Now development of this male urethra or the various parts of the male urethra, the caudal part of the vesicoureteral canal. We know the vesicoureteral canal is contributing to the urinary bladder and the primitive urethra. So the prostatic part of the urethra extending from urinary bladder to the opening of ejaculatory duct. So this is the portion which is derived from the caudal portion of vesicoureteral canal. The original opening of mesonephric duct, where the actually the mesonephric duct, they are joining the you can say this junctional point of vesicoureteral canal and the that is the urogenital sinus, that is definitive urogenital sinus. At this point the mesonephric ducts, they are opening. So this portion is basically the level of that. So it is endodermal in origin. Then the posterior wall of this part is derived from absorbed mesonephric duct. It is mesoderm. So mesodermal in origin. So this is the first part. So primitive urethra, you can see in the second diagram. Now second, the pelvic part of, as I have told you, the definitive urogenital sinus is divided into pelvic part and phallic part. Now this pelvic part of the definitive urogenital sinus is contributing to two parts of the urethra, that is prostatic part and membranous part. So this membranous and prostatic part, they are arising from this pelvic portion. And the phallic part of the definitive urogenital sinus is going to form the penile part of the urethra. Then surface ectoderm, that is this portion, is going to form the glandular part. So prostatic part, which is derived from the primitive urethra, you can see, or it is the basically derived from the vesicoureteral canal, and part of the pelvic part of the definitive urogenital sinus, that is contributing to the prostatic portion. Membranous urethra is developing from the pelvic part of the definitive urogenital sinus. Penile part is developing from the phallic part of definitive urogenital sinus, and glandular portion is developing from the surface ectoderm. Now development of the female urethra. Female urethra is short, about 4 cm. Most of the female urethra develops from the caudal part of the vesicoureteral canal, as it is same in case of males. So except a small terminal part which develops from the pelvic part of definitive urogenital sinus. So this is endodermal in origin. A small part of the dorsal wall, that is from absorbed part of the mesonephric duct, is also contributing to the formation of this urethra. So it is mesodermal. Then the phallic part of the urogenital sinus forms the vestibule of the vagina. You can see here in the diagram. So this is the diagram showing the caudal portion of the vesicoureteral canal, pelvic portion and phallic portion of the urogenital sinus. So how they are contributing? So this caudal portion is going to form this portion of the female urethra. Major portion is derived from this, you can see. So this small portion is derived from the pelvic part of the definitive urogenital sinus, and this phallic part is contributing to the vestibule of the vagina. So this is regarding the development of female urethra. Now if we compare the two diagrams, that is of the development of female urethra and male urethra, so female urethra is corresponding to the prostatic part of the male urethra. You can see this portion. Rest of the portion is vestibule, which is just contributed by the phallic portion. So this is regarding the development of the female and male urethra. Now coming to the anamnesis of urethra, there may be obstruction of the urethra at its junction with the bladder, may show diverticula, may be duplicated in whole or in part, there may be abnormal communication with the rectum. So hypospadias and epispadias, they can occur. So these two conditions we will discuss in our next lecture. So this is all about the development of the urinary bladder and urethra. So if you have any doubt, you can write in the comment box. And if you like my video, kindly like it, share it and subscribe it. So I will be happy to hear comment from your side. Thank you very much.